Hello everyone. I know it's 2 o'clock. You might have lunch as well, so we'll try to make it as fun as possible. So let's see how it goes. Welcome to CI/CD on the OpenShift. The title talk was the CI/CD on the OpenShift for developer, but there is a change. Just a minute. Yeah. The change is for the Bob. Now the question is, who is Bob, basically? So Bob is a developer, obvious. But Bob loves building the applications and deploying applications. The kind of applications developed Bob is like a small set of applications, web services kind of workload. But those are the just not one application, but it is a set of applications. Essentially form it as the set of the microservices, or it is basically microservice. Obviously, these are small applications, so the Bob is basically package this and run it as the containers rather than running on the traditional VM environments. Hence, these are the different set of the services and the applications. So Bob keeps releasing and deploying at their individual pace compared to the what we used to deploy traditional the monolith rather than taking in the batch of the changes and deploy it in the production or roll it in the production, the any environment, right? So basically, Bob workload is looks like build, test, deploy, repeat, build, test, deploy, repeat. And basically, this is that at the end to some form as a CI/CD. Just one question. How many of you feel that you are Bob here? OK, great. How many of you would like to be a Bob in case? Great. So but there are a few challenges at the Bob fields. So one thing is like, CI/CD, basically we form it as the continuous integration, continuous deployment. We continuously integrated all the changes through our in our source code and keep those changes of and keep releasing and deploying our applications into the target environment, essentially the production environment. So Bob needs some mechanism where he can define, or she can, basically, it's not gender bias, but basically Bob needs a mechanism where he can define the CI/CD definition, which says that how to take the source code and get it to the production environment, correct? Now to understand that definition, Bob needs some sort of the mechanism, right? I'm basically the CI/CD server that can execute the jobs for the, each of the applications that Bob is building. And at the end, that application need to understand, so the CI/CD server need to understand if there is a change in the application's source code state, it need to take the source code change, right? It need to test, build, deploy, or the build, test, deploy, whatever the flow is, correct? Now coming back to the build step is basically, as a developer, or writing the CI/CD, we need some mechanism or the tools that can take your source code and package, basically create or executable form of your application and package it as a container, right? So we need some tools, or the Bob needs some tools to build the containers. And then it needs also some tools or the way where he can take the same container image and ship it to the target environment. It may be stage, testing, or it may be production environments, correct? So, yeah. And at the end, those are the environments we need for deploying our application. It may be stage, products, again, it depends. So these are the few challenges. This is essentially, we are seeing the one box for the challenges, right? But imagine the first thing we have said that it's just, Bob is not dealing with just one application. Bob is dealing with multiple set of applications. Right, so Bob needs to recreate all those things for the each and every applications to basically implement a CI/CD pipeline, correct? And putting all together, yay, now Bob is the builder. He's a developer, but now he's building something. But the pain point for the Bob is he really don't like to set up all these pipeline definitions, right? Because if the Bob is building, let's say, 10 and 15 applications, in fact, right, he needs to probably reinvent the wheel or more of like he needs to write down or do this mundane repetitive work for the each and every applications. Then there how it comes in the microservices, or more of like the if you are having the multiple applications in the system, we need some DevOps engineer, the platform engineers help, so they can help a developer to set up their CI/CD pipelines, correct? And hence, as a developer, they keep reinventing the wheel. And that essentially one of the problem in the microservices or the multiple set of application where the people are continuously deploying, we need to solve. And here, the OpenShift come to rescue to some extent, yes. And let's see how Tris help us. So basically, OpenShift comes with a built-in CI/CD, or more of like the pipeline definition, which is, you can think, is more of like the managed service we can still deploy while building, basically executing our CI/CD workloads. Since it is, we know that Kubernetes and the OpenShift is more of like already container-based form. So it basically comes out of box with the scalability. So where we can, for each pipeline, we can basically execute a bunch of the loads or the workloads or the parts in the different set of containers altogether, right? So that's how the system can scale. In traditional Jenkins philosophy, we can say it's more of like the master. Master just interpret the definition of the job and actually delegate the workload to the slave, right? But let's see if it is that really easy. Still the moment we'll figure out. Our most important thing, the Jenkins that comes with the OpenShift has includes some batteries, essentially a few of the plugins that helps a developer to write down the pipeline, some of the steps, in more of like the declarative way. We are just going to say it. And yes, and it comes with some bunch of the configurations along with that plugins as well. So that's about solving the one part of the executing a CI/CD job. Now let's see how we can build our containers, the applications. So OpenShift also provides, engineers provides the, something called the source to image. So basically, its source to image is more of like intended for maybe developer for the other purpose, but basically, it takes your application source code, right? Whether it would be current directory or the working directory, but essentially, here it taking your source code from the Git URL. Here it taking some base image. Now that base image has assumed that it's, we call it as a builder image, and the builder image knows basically how to create your application source code into executable form and put it into a container package, or more of like the container image, right? And then it says that create an Hello Python application out of your S2I build. So now, if we take the same construct into a pipeline, we have something called the build API. Essentially, it's kind of the declarative API. We just say that, okay, this is how it looks like. I'm not sure if you're able to see it. Okay, great. So basically, it takes your source code, right? And then basically says that I want to use some sort of the strategy. For the time being, assume that this is the way, similar mechanism that we have executed in the S2I. It's take your builder image, and it basically essentially produces your target image, let's say Ruby app for your source code, right? This is how the declarative way the OpenShift allows to build your application containers. Then let's look at the deploy thing. So basically, when we need to deploy our applications, usually the application will be standalone, or maybe applications also comes with the dependent services. For example, we say database, message queues, and caching systems, right? And probably we need to ship all these applications together in the one flow, or we want to deploy all these applications in the one flow. So OpenShift provides something called the OpenShift templates. So we can think of it as, again, one of the declarative form of the YAML, where we can define all our application resources, including your applications, dependent services. But one of the magic of the template is it allows the parameterization of our applications, right? So when you say parameterization, to think of the previous example, we want to take our builder image, or more of like our application image, right? And when we execute our CI/CD pipeline, we need to, instead of tagging as the latest image, like this one, we want to tag it with a particular build number or the particular image, particular CI/CD version number itself, right? So we can templatize in this way, and we can pass all those parameters while executing our CI/CD job. We'll later on see that, how actually we are going to pass those parameters, but that's how we can templatize our application workflow. And we use the same template to deploy our applications onto the any kind of the environment. We just need to customize those specific parameters related to applications while shipping onto the particular target environment. And most important part, as a developer, we need some sort of the DSL. Because as a developer, probably we are not more of like writing the pipeline definition, which 100 lines of the code or the 100 lines of the configuration lines, right? So we have something called the declarative DSL APIs that essentially provide very primitive APIs, as we've seen previously. Take my templates, build my applications, and deploy to my target environment. We will going to see that how it's essentially forms the declarative APIs, but as well as it provides some sort of the Jenkins steps, or more of like very fluent ESL APIs that is essentially helps to interact with the OpenShift and do execute some complex environments. So for example, I want to build an application in the one cluster, and then I need to take that application image into the another cluster to deploy it to the different cluster, right? So it provides us my form of the DSL APIs. So for example, if you see, the first one you were saying that the declarative APIs, if you can see here, we are just processing our templates that we have discussed previously. Now basically we are taking all the resources generated from this template and building our applications. Then we are just declaratively saying that, hey, take this my applications and deploy it to the stage environment. Stage environment is nothing but my environment where I want to ship. And again, I want to take the same applications and deploy to the run or more of like the production environment, but with manual approval. So these kind of the pipeline API, it provides one of the library we have. And the part I was discussing about provide the Jenkins steps, it's something like this. We can create the multiple clusters, then more of like queries the resources, and basically we can do more of like the iterate over the resources, right? So now we don't need to do all those CLIs, I think executing shell scripts. So it's provide nice wrapper around your basically OC CLI, the way we interact with the OpenShift itself, right? And so basically, but how to get everything is together. So here we have something called the Codeready toolchain. It's more of like the managed service that allows basically developers to bring these all things together and open-ended way of building your application or more of like exiting CI/CD application on the OpenShift. Essentially helps the developers to scaffold your application. In a sense, it helps to generate the default Jenkins file or more of like the pipeline definition, then provide the templates for your applications, then set up all the webhooks, right? And it basically forms, get everything in the place. So as a developer, it's more of like a CI/CD as a service, but as a developer, you can feel off it is like, I don't want to deal with most of the setup. Just give me something out of box where I can go consume it, and I can more of like get ready to deploy and code my applications. So that's how we are saying it's more of like wiring everything for your developers. Now, enough talk. Let's see some of the demos and try to understand how everything works in reality, right? So enough, Bob want to go into action, and here is what Bob want to do. Bob want to set up a Node.js applications, essentially an application which says that it's ready to build and deploy, but not only deploy in simple way, it's you want to deploy to the stage. And as soon as we build an application, but again, we want to deploy the same applications on the prod with some sort of manual approval, right? But all these things, it's going to happen in less than 5 minutes. Let's see if things work. Sure, so here I'm just showing the video recording because it would take some time to do everything, but at the end of the demo, we are going to see everything in system. So basically, I'm going to the Codeready.com. Basically, it's Codeready application. It's a hosted application where I'm creating some space. For the time being, let's keep it abstract. Let's not worry about it. And now the next part is like, I want to create a Node.js application. And this platform provides some sample templates where we can use to create simple web services. A web service which would provide some hello endpoint, but some sort of the additional feature that really works, helps really well with the OpenShift of the Kubernetes environment. So here we are creating one health check applications for the Node.js stack. Here is the most important thing. As a user, I can select what kind of the application workflow I want to execute. Here we are saying that build my image, roll out it to stage, and then with the manual approach, roll out it to run. So once we select that kind of pipeline for our project, it just asks to provide the name for your GitHub repository. At the end, we're just going to review, and we are saying that set up my application. And at the end, yes, this is how things are happening. It's essentially creating your project in the GitHub repo, then basically configuring everything. It's basically wiring all the GitHub webhooks with the Jenkins that is already running in your OpenShift environment. and it's setting your pipeline. Done. As a developer, you are kind of all set to do everything. Now let's see actually what is happening behind the scene. Yeah, this is the OpenShift console. We can see that it has created the pipeline. So as a user, as a developer, you don't need to worry about how it's going to create a pipeline for myself, right? But where is my pipeline definition at this moment? So let's see. Here you can see the same project has been created in one of the Jenkins, which is running in the user's environment. And everything is still progressing. And now let's see some of the things. So if you look at the source code of the project that it has created, we have something called the Jenkins files here, which is nothing but your pipeline definitions. It's more of like the bunch of the step. It's instruct the Jenkins how to do everything as a CI/CD workflow. And there is something called the .openshift.io folder that we are going to look at. But let's look at the Jenkins files first. So it uses the declarative DSL that we were discussing before, right? It's called the OCO pipeline, correct? But now let's look at the actually CD definition. Think as a developer how declarative it is. It's just simply saying that put something in the CD block, which is nothing but this continuous deployment. Put something in the CI block, which is nothing but continuous integration. Continuous deployment would trigger whenever there is a change in the master. And basically CI would trigger when there is when the user or the developer submit a PR to repository. But look at it's just simply saying that take this the template, pass this the parameters to the template that we have discussed earlier in case of the Ruby image example. Then we are saying that whatever the resources generated out of processing template step, take those, build the applications out of it, deploy the application out of it. And now let's look at how this template look exactly that template looks like. This is the .openshift.io directory that we are discussing, and this is the OpenShift template that we are discussing. Now, it's kind of the YAML, it's again declarative way, but it's essentially taking few of the parameters. So when we run our pipeline, so for example, when we're executing a pipeline, we can say that use this release version number and tag my image, take that image and deploy it to my environment. And for the time being, let's ignore the image stream, but understand the build config that we have discussed already, how to build my applications. And so it's again essentially taking very similar form. It's saying that create an image out of it. This is my the Git repository I'm going to provide. This is the commit ID that I'm going to provide here. And this is kind of the builder image that we are going to use. This is the builder image it's going to use that essentially knows how to build your app, your application. And this is essentially nothing but the deployment config in the services and the routes. Essentially tells the OpenShift is basically how to basically deploy your application or basically how to run your containers and basically then provide a construct to access, it's more of like creator routes and the services. So the user can access the application outside the cluster. For the time being in the abstract, that's how we can say that. And now, this is actually the first job that is running in your Jenkins. Essentially, it's executing the OC process, that it's more of like the template processing. As a user, you don't need to worry about how things are being done. But essentially, the beauty of this DSL is like, again, it's leveraging on the same OC CLI that provides by the OpenShift, right? So nothing magic as such. It just provides nice wrapper DSL around it. It's taking your build config, and it essentially started building your applications. It's running, building your applications. Yeah, we can see that. Right, and once we see everything is working, and now it's, we can see that our pipeline is still progressing. Yeah. This is how it has basically rolled out our applications to the stage environment. And then it's going to ask for the manual approval, and then it's going to just process your template and take the deployment conferences out of it and just going to deploy our applications to the given namespace of the project in the OpenShift. So that's it for the demo. And just one demo I just want to provide to get the glimpse of, as an user, how your CI/CD pipeline can access the resources from the other clusters, right? So here is just simple definition. We are saying that with some sort of the credentials, just query those credentials are more of like for the given project or for the given cluster URL, give the project details and more of like by default, if you are not going the particular project and the particular cluster, then it's going to just print the default current project working space where it is configured. Now if we see as an output of this pipeline, we can essentially see that this is not default project. It is actually accessing some other cluster or other project namespace, which is running on some other OpenShift cluster, let's say, or some other one. But the default one is something like this, the A-A Jenkins, so for example, right? So that's how this, as a user, you can leverage on this pipeline and still take the advantage of. Yeah, so, excuse me. So here is, we are trying to make the Bob happy. So he's just not developer, now he's builder. He is able to ship the applications. And yes, thank you for listening to this presentation. This is the team we are working. Any questions for this talk?
Can this Codeready toolkit can be installed on a local OpenShift installation, not on online, but on our self-hosted platform?
Sure. So the question is, can we take this Codeready setup and just run it on our local setup, or it has to be online? Right now, it's always an online, it's a managed service. But if as a user or the developer, you want to take everything, everything is on the GitHub. To be honest, it's not really that well documented, but if you understand the Kubernetes and OpenShift, you can take all these things, and actually you can spin up all the services on your OpenShift cluster, because everything is running on the OpenShift, but to be honest, it's really hard at this moment.
Okay. And will it be in the future? I mean, do you have the plans to create a package for local machines?
Yes, we have a plan for that.
And for 4.0, for 4 version or something for free could be available?
At this moment, we are really not sure. But it's essentially, we are more of like targeting all our current plans, considering the 4.0 as the center. But yes, definitely, we may then focus on the previous versions of the OpenShift. So.
We have seen kind of form-based tool to generate the Jenkins files, but at some point you have modified the Jenkins file for this multi-cluster and so on. So is there any way to configure this visual to include different new pipelines and parameter these pipelines so the developer is able to set up it with the standard enterprise or company-wide pipeline definition?
So you meant to say, if I understood you correctly, you want to take the existing Jenkins file generations and more of like customize it for the particular.
Let's say and the company has a kind of pipeline defined for the developers on 2, 3, 4, like you have in your tool. So is there a way to configure that tool to set up this pipeline, this company pipeline?
Sure, we can set up. So for example, if we go back and look at the first line of our library, right? So basically, at this moment, there are two things. So one thing is the DSL APIs, if you're considering. Those are more of like, can be used with any OpenShift environment, not only this one. That is the first thing, right? And second thing is like, again, you can extend or create the existing pipeline DSLs, right? And probably you can create more of like customized DSL for your enterprise company, and probably you can package it and ship it it's quite easy to replace and use that extended version. I'm not sure if it does that answers your question. Sure, then probably we can discuss it offline if you want, right? Sure. Thank you very much for joining and attending.